हरि ओम नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परब्रह्मा तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। अवर नेशनल हेरिटेज बिगिन्स विद द वेदास and it should have been heralded a resurgence with our country's independence. Sri Aurobindo, on whose birthday our country attained independence, dreamed of national education. By national education he meant our own education, not foreign education, which we all today still continue in our colleges and universities. Lord Macaulay, who framed this educational policy, very clearly mentioned it. It is aimed to make every Indian into an Englishman. And before long, if we don't restore back our national heritage, we will be all duplicate prints of George Bush or Mao Zedong or anybody else other than Indians. So our cultural freedom begins with the liberation of our education. Therefore, even while serving as a civil servant, it was my homework to prepare the first textbook of Vedic Hinduism. When I met the Shankaracharya in the year 1975 and requested him to give me a summary of our Vedic religion, of what is popularly called Hinduism, he said, "What do I know?" I was shocked. I thought that they are know all knowing. He said, "I can talk about Advaita, I can talk about Hindu philosophy or any other topic, but to give you the four corners of the Vedic religion as a textbook of physics would," he said, "it is beyond me." Then it dawned on me that nobody can write a textbook of Vedic Hinduism unless he has a firm and deep roots in science. It is not just philosophy, it is science. Not one science as modern sciences would like to have, but it is a synthesis of all sciences. Sri Aurobindo dreamed of a day when all the sciences will be unified into one supreme synthesis. But I was surprised to find that they were already synthesized into one supreme science of yoga. The Bhagavad Gita, the summary of the four Vedas, taught by a master, a divine master, to a human disciple, is a permanent textbook. It teaches about the origin of the universe, the formation of the solar system, the beginning of time, the creation of man, the evolution of animals, plants, and even the souls on this earth, the law of karma, about which many have made fun of us, calling us fatalists. So I started to hit the nail on the head Newton's law of action and reaction is nothing but a plagiarism of the law of karma in the physics world. If you take a tennis ball and hit the wall, it will come back with the same momentum. That is the statement of Newtonian physics. Our rishis knew that the law of karma operates not only in the world of inert matter, but also mentally, physically, spiritually. If we hurt others, the pain will come back to us. Lord Buddha taught ahimsa is therefore spreading goodwill and joy and love to all living creatures, so that ultimately it will come back to you as an insurance policy in divine trust. Basically, if you want to be happy, you have to make others happy. If you want to be learned, you have to spread knowledge. If you want to be good to others. This is the crux of the Vedic religion. It is also the Anusiddhanta, the atomic theory, the mathematics of Bodhayana Rishi, the so-called Pythagoras theorem of our rishis, which I mentioned in the textbook of Vedic sciences. This word Pythagoras is a Greek corruption of the Sanskrit word Pythagoras. If you read the life of Alexander, the Greek adventurer, so many Greeks came to India. They learnt at the feet of the rishis. It is recorded. Modern scientists, till recently, they used to believe that the earth is the center. The church has hanged a number of scientists for preaching heresy. But if you go back to the Vedas, the Surya Siddhanta, Soma Siddhanta, the Brihaspati Siddhanta, 18 Siddhantas of astronomy are commented by a man no less than Burgess, Reverend Burgess, a Christian father who has no word to say about the science of the Vedas. So it is a calculated transformation of Vedic religion and a Vedic nation into a nation of people who are foreigners to themselves. So therefore, I considered it as my God-given duty. And whatever privileges God has given as Gurukula education in my childhood, Vedic education in my middle age, and a degree in modern science in my 20s, I was a professor in Dayala at 21 because of the Gayatri Mantra. Modern Western education is about transferring information from outside into the mind of the student. And ancient education is about taking out knowledge from your soul. It is based on the yoga theory that the human soul is divine in a sense, and all information is stored as a supercomputer memory connected to the cosmic computer. Therefore, eka vijnanena sarva vijnana pratijna, as Maharshi Vedavyasa said. This is my pratijna, he said, by knowing which you will know everything. So such is the basis of our Vedic education. But it is no use praising it. It has to be taught systematically, painfully, patiently, and also not merely teaching the bookish knowledge. We have to teach them asanas, pranayam, mantra. There are a few special points about our university. The senior students teach to the junior students. Thereby, the barrier between the student and the teacher is obliterated. The idea is all your life you are a student and all your life you are a teacher. It is our idea that once a child enters our Gurukula school at the age of 7, they come up to the 10th standard, get our undergraduate certificate, then get into our graduation. so that once you enter this university, you need not leave elsewhere for any other course or for any intermediate stages in education. So it's a complete education.